I do the same thing I told you that I never would. I told you I changed, even when I knew I never could. Know that I can't find nobody else.
Hello everyone, and welcome to our Lab Coats and Beyond speaker series. With us today is David Cook. David Cook is a PhD candidate at the Ottawa Hospital Research Institute. His research focuses on understanding how cancer cells adapt to changes in their environment, resisting therapies, and evading the immune system. Throughout his graduate work, he has published 22 studies and has received numerous awards. This includes the Ronald G. Worton Researcher in Training Award and the Frederick Banting and Charles Best Doctoral Award. Through his own struggles with imposter syndrome and handling rejection, David has become passionate about crafting processes for how we do work rather than focusing on our individual goals. So with that being said, thank you all for tuning in, and we hope you enjoy the seminar.
I want to talk to you about something that has become kind of increasingly important to me through the final years of my graduate studies. And it's something I think we all kind of need to talk about more often, especially at the stages you're at as you're, you know, maybe finishing high school, trying to figure out what you're going to do for the rest of your life, or trying to make critical decisions about which university to go to. Or if you're in your undergraduate, maybe trying to decide what your career path is, or trying to figure out if you're going to make it into medicine or not, or you know, what graduate study you want to go into. You're all at this moment, it probably seems like very critical moments of your life. And I wanted it to kind of reset the way we think about it a little bit and tell you a little bit about maybe my experience to, and hopefully we can make this informal and try to bring some perspective to the process of science and your career. So throughout my PhD, I was very, very fortunate to have a productive experience. It resulted in a handful of papers, invited seminars across North America, presented work over in Europe as well. This received various awards and accolades. We received research funding to actually run the research that we wanted to do, and all throughout this was able to maintain scientific outreach and try to keep just kind of this more of a nice kind of work-life balance. So I put these kind of accolades or parts of my CV up here, not to sound like a jerk and to brag for anything. And I purposely tried to walk that line a little bit, because I want you to reflect a little bit about how you feel when you hear things like this. Reflect a little bit on your emotional response. If you start thinking about, you know, yourself and your capacity to accomplish things in your field. I don't know how many of you are interested in things like research versus medicine versus anything else, but I think regardless, it still stands. So when you hear things like this, how do you feel? And this is one of the things that I learned early on in my undergraduate studies, actually, is that there's a lot of moments in science and your kind of academic path where, and probably in life in general, where you are faced with the kind of accomplishments of others. And I think there's this weird human response that probably has some sort of evolutionary benefit to evaluate yourself against what you're being told. And this has led to serious, serious issues in science around imposter syndrome and this kind of sense of not belonging, or like that you can't make it. And maybe more general in life. I mean, I think you've all scrolled through Instagram or things like that and saw how sweet other people's lives are. And maybe you have a friend who you know the behind the scenes things of what their lives are like, and you get to see the types of things they post. And what I wanted to do today is try to assure you that the same kind of phenomenon happens in academics and careers as well. It's just how it's set up, is that you're often only ever told the accomplishments and not what went into those accomplishments or all the things that didn't pan out. So I wanted to take maybe the first half of this talk to tell you about my own kind of personal path. And although on paper, it seems like a very, very successful, smooth sailing career, I can promise you it hasn't been anything but that. So I want to talk a little bit about failure in science and go over my own kind of failure rejection CV. So maybe going back as early as high school, which, you know, when I talk about this, it seems like ages ago, but I know some of you, this wasn't too far back. So it's kind of interesting there. But this was my grade 10 science report card. In high school, I had absolutely no affinity for science at all. I took, you know, grade 9, 10 science because you had to. I did not take grade 11 or 12 biology. I only took grade 11 chemistry. I was going to take grade 12 chemistry, but I dropped it for a music co-op. And it's fun seeing this because I got a 68 in the course, and there's a little message from the teacher that I recommend that the student takes this at a college level. And in fact, when I was in high school, I didn't even take enough academic level courses to go to university. And the reason for this is I grew up in the early to mid 2000s, which was the emo days. So of course I played guitar in a rock band. And at the time, this was, you know, the only thing on my mind. And I just had this assumption that I was going to, you know, I don't need school. I'm going to make it big with my music. But obviously, you know, we finished high school and that's not what we ended up doing for the rest of our lives. So I was kind of left wondering what to do. So I thought, if I'm not going to be the guy that's in the band, maybe I'll be the guy that records bands. And I actually went and worked at a recording studio for several years, also working at a restaurant on the side because there wasn't enough recording business to keep us afloat. And it wasn't until about 3 years after high school that I said, you know what, maybe I didn't give science enough of a shot. And I've always tried to reflect about what the decision making was for this. And part of it was, you know, I'd floated around for 3 years, not really seeing any evidence that I was going anywhere in my life. You know, I'd been living with my girlfriend ever since moving out after high school, who's my wife now. So, you know, she was proceeding on with her career, and maybe I was feeling a little bit left behind. And then also maybe I was really into the show House at the time, and I was like, oh, medicine is cool. And I promise you, the only reason I say this is because I guarantee there are some Grey's Anatomy kids in the audience right now who, if you were to be honest with yourself, that might be a big motivator of why you're interested in science and medicine. And that's fine. There's nothing wrong with that. You can get your inspiration from anything. But I did. So I decided actually to go to adult high school to get my biology credits. And I don't know if it was just because I had some sort of interest in biology to begin with and I never explored it, or if I was just more mature when I was approaching school now, but I actually really, really started to love biology and understanding how, you know, the human body works. I did not like fungus biology or plant biology, but the human physiology was really, really interesting. So I stuck it out for a year going to adult high school, and, you know, I'd been out of school for so long, and I didn't think I could go through another 8 years of school just to be a doctor, which is funny to think back on now. So I said, you know what, I like the idea of healthcare. I'm going to go into nursing. So I went into the nursing program at the University of Ottawa, and that's where I fell in love with university and education. University was cool because it was the first time where you started to get to tailor your own education to your own interests. And also, it's, you know, it's not 8 to 4. We were only doing about 15 hours of class a week, plus like labs or whatever. But it started to feel, you know, a bit more up my alley. And I'm like, I could do this for a bit longer. So I decided I was going to be a doctor. I was going to stick it through and go to medical school. So after the first year of nursing, I switched into a generic pre-med program called health sciences, and just kind of trucked along. And I was really, really enjoying my school at that time. I anatomy and physiology were my favorite courses. And in fact, if there are you Ottawa students there, I might have TA'd you. So I started to reflect a little bit about what I loved about biology. And it was that I loved the ability to ask, why does something happen the way it happens? Or, you know, why do these symptoms emerge when a patient or a human has something going on? And it was really this question asking that I realized I started to that I was enjoying. And I kind of fell into it, but I ended up thinking that maybe research is what this is all about. You get to ask questions and figure out how things are working the way they are. But I'd never really given it a shot. So I switched out of that health sciences, still unsure about medical school or research. And I went into a program that gave me a fourth year honors research project. And I did that. And the minute I stepped into the lab, I absolutely loved it. Your job every day was to ask questions people don't have the answers to. There are times where you are the only person in the world to know something. And you can't Google the answers to these things. It's problem solving at core. And I love that. So I immediately jumped ship and decided, nope, I don't think medicine is for me. I was going to go through with research. And I did. So I entered my master's, again, absolutely loved it. I did a master's in 2 years. And most graduate programs in Canada have this option where you can start in a master's and transfer directly into your PhD after a year without having to finish the thesis. Things were going well for me. So I'm thinking, oh, this is going to be no problem. I can do my PhD and then be done in a handful of years. So I get to the transfer exam and I fail. In fact, this was a note from one of my three thesis evaluators. And I'll read it because it really packed a punch. And this is a direct quote, and I still have this document. It says, considering the lack of progress made by David in the last year, it is not clear whether David is capable of pursuing his PhD at this time. And that is capable is the part that really punched the most. Because, you know, I thought I was smart. I thought things were going well. And this is someone telling me that they don't think I might not be able to do it. And that sucked. This was really, really soul crushing. But now, you know, with this being years in the past, I can honestly say that this was probably one of the best things to ever happen to me. Because I managed to build up somehow enough courage to keep going forward. And I finished my master's actually defending a thesis and then started my PhD, no problem. But when I started my PhD, I was able to do it with the experience of having done a master's. I crafted a new project. I got to design it the way I wanted to. And really, that was the key to all the things I showed at the start of this presentation. Oh, I did forget to mention, right. So I didn't have the courage to go straight through. In fact, I got really mad at the University of Ottawa and I said, okay, fine. You don't want me. I'm going to go to a big hardcore school. So I applied to the MIT biology program, again, a little bit cocky, and I got rejected without even an interview. So then I went to the PhD program at the University of Ottawa. And then the PhD overall has been fairly smooth, but it's where I've realized that, you know, the road is always going to have bumps in it. So although I showed awards that I've received, that's by far the exception to the rule here. This is a folder I keep of various scholarships I've applied to. It's a tiny bit outdated now, but it still kind of holds. So I like to keep track of the awards I receive and those that I don't. And from this alone, you can see that the vast majority of things you apply for, you do not get. And although I pull out the green dots and that's what I tell you on paper, you don't see the 18 or the however many other I apply to and don't even get considered for. So in fact, there's this CIHR doctoral award that I received, which is very, very great. Just one year before it. And honestly, my CV didn't even change that much in that year. I was in the bottom 15% of the people who applied for this award. And again, so just like reflect on how you think about yourself when you hear others' awards, because I think we put ourselves down way more than we should. And it's not just the awards, right? In science, we kind of, our money is publications. That's kind of the currency in science. And you see people publishing papers all the time and you go, wow, like they do all this cool science. They publish so much. And again, you don't always see the what went into that. One thing I like to do is a lot of journals will have this thing where they say when the article was received versus when it was published. And you'll see that a lot of these papers went through, they sat in limbo for a year getting evaluated in peer review. And in fact, this paper here, an earlier one, got published in November 12, 2018. This was the sixth place we sent this article and we submitted to the first journal over a year before that. So it's a marathon. And this was another one. This was journal number 5, that's right. And that was after going through 4 journals who for various reasons tell you that your paper is not up to par with what they want to publish. And this isn't meant to be a woe is me, oh, look how hard it is. But this is just kind of, it's trying to reveal, I think, the norm of science. And I talk about science because that's the experience here, but I think this probably holds for most, you know, knowledge-based professions. We always face, you know, harsh critique. And in science, it's kind of unfortunate because this critique has this kind of veil that they call peer review, which almost gives people the right to tell you how bad you are and you know, why your stuff doesn't deserve. But I really want to get across the message that you're not alone in this. And in fact, people tend to want to beat themselves up for this, but this is the process. And really getting through it is about finding ways to be okay with that and to persevere through it. So if I can give throughout this, I'll try to give little nuggets of practical advice. my first piece of practical advice is, you know, stop comparing what you experience to what others display, because they are not equal comparisons. Others will only display the best parts about themselves. It's that classic Instagram thing that I was talking about, but you're experiencing the whole thing for yourself, the ups and the downs. And an extension of this, I would say, is stop comparing where you are now to where people are at different stages. At the start of this, I showed you parts of my CV. I am far older than probably most of you, and have been in this for longer. So it's like there's a time difference here. You can't be hard on yourself for not having accomplished this stuff if you haven't been in it for longer periods of time. So in the second part, I kind of want to talk about, okay, well, so science is hard. Let's not beat ourselves up. But what can we do to try to succeed? Because given how much rejection you get, I can tell you if you're only focused on those like accomplishments, those discrete events, like getting a paper published, getting an award, getting into medical school, you're going to be disappointed for the majority of your career, because like I said, most shots fail. So what can you do? And the more I think about it, really, I want to get across that kind of success is actually, it's kind of boring, the process of it. All in, like, it involves the three things that you have to give in life: your time, your effort, and your focus. And if you commit a good enough amount of these things and use it effectively, then the things will follow. One kind of mindset that I had earlier on in my education, I think was bad, was being very focused on those discrete events. Like you're looking for your big break. Maybe that dates back to when I was a musician. And so if you're thinking about going to medical school, maybe in your mind, you're just thinking about getting that acceptance letter to medical school. But I would like to try to encourage you that try to focus less on goals and ambitions and more on the actions it takes in theory to get those things. I'm becoming more against this kind of like goal mindset that people have. And I don't say the goals aren't important, because you need to know what direction ahead. You have to have this kind of this motivation to see where you're headed. But if you're just focusing on goals, life is going to suck. You're delaying gratification until the future. And then when you get there, then what? And also goals alone aren't going to get you there. One thing I read from this actually book, I quote here, Atomic Habits. There's this really nice part that says, you know, winners and losers all had the same goal. Like if you're looking at Olympic athletes, every one of them, their goal was to win gold, but only one person was. So actually accomplishing this isn't about having the goal. It's about the process you have to get there. The goals are important, but they're not going to get you there alone. Action is key. Define your goals, but then focus on day-to-day what you can do to try to get there. If your goal is to get into medical school, there are plenty of resources online to say what it takes to get into medical school. You need straight A's, you need a bunch of extracurriculars and life experiences and to be a well-rounded person. Start taking those steps. How do you get straight A's? Well, you have to do well in your courses. You have to study. It's that work that's going to get you there. If you want to be a successful researcher, you have to publish papers. That's pretty much the big thing. So how do you publish papers? You do the experiments and you actually write those results. A lot of researchers get kind of lost in just doing the experiments and not writing the results. So it's all about figuring out what it takes to get there and then doing it. One example of this I like that I heard, I think first from Malcolm Gladwell. And it was like, so you wanna be an author. So the average nonfiction book is about 75,000 words. And the average author writes about 1,000 words a day. So you should be able to pump out 3 novels a year in theory, right? But even professional authors don't do this. And this is because I think it's kind of a human nature thing that we like to avoid the actions. We love dreaming about the accomplishments, but I think we're reluctant to actually jump into the work. So find ways to motivate yourself to do the day-to-day tasks that are boring, like studying, but that will get you there in the long run. And then if you say, but what if I don't have what it takes to make it? Maybe my argument about failure and all that still doesn't motivate you and you're still not sure that you have what it takes. I can promise you that the difference in intelligence, ability to work and skills and all that between you and the dream person for your job is far smaller than you think it is. I would say the average person in your field is probably bad at working and isn't particularly smart. This holds for doctors, physicians. This holds for faculty at universities. I mean, I think there's a true thing that most people aren't good at being highly productive workers. And I think we often inflate true differences in intelligence. So I'm not saying disrespect people and call them stupid and all that, but I'm trying to say that the jump that you would have to take to be up there in that field is much smaller than you think it is. Respect these people, but don't idolize them. And if you develop good work habits, your ability to actually be productive in whatever industry you work in, and to do this consistently, that will get you to the top of your field. This whole bad at working thing, there was one study I really liked that they surveyed knowledge workers in a variety of industries throughout their workday. They would just kind of like jump in and ask them if they were focused on their task or daydreaming. And 47% of the time when they talked to someone, the person was not focused on their task. So the ability to channel your focus and actually put that into work is immediately going to put you ahead. So some rapid fire, just kind of like general tips here. Being busy is not a proxy for being productive. This is so critical, especially to you in university. In undergrad, there's always this weird posturing thing, especially in the med school path, of people who will tell you how much stuff they're doing. And I think we have this tendency again to compare ourselves and think we're not doing enough. But being productive is not about doing a lot of things. There's this nice kind of perspective that I read about this, about this idea of being busy as productive. A lot of that might come from back in the industrial era, where productivity could be measured. It was the amount of things made per unit of time. But now that was, you know, manufacturing, like I said, the industrial age. So, but what about knowledge work? So things like publishing a paper, or coming up with a tricky diagnosis for a patient, or things like that. How do you measure whether you're being productive? It is not about doing a lot of things, but I think a lot of people fall into that trap. You'll hear professors at university talking about, you know, how much email they get in a day, or all the meetings they have. And these are things they have to do, but that is not the measurement of productivity in these careers. So don't try to make yourself busy thinking that that's gonna make you productive. Learn time management as early as you can. Because of COVID, I actually had an interesting experience where I got to read student surveys of first year undergrads reflecting before and after their first midterm. And I would say I read about 350 surveys, and about 300 of them said that they struggled because they were not able to manage their time to study for the exam. It's kind of a shame that your education doesn't kind of train you to manage your time. That's not part of the curriculum, but it is so important to be an efficient worker. So I will challenge you, find strategies that work for you. Treat your time seriously. It is one of the only things you have to give in your life. Say no to things that don't help. One thing I was told, which is, I really like this, is no is the best word in the English language because it is the only word that will give you more time. So don't do things that aren't effective towards what you want to do, and then use your time efficiently. Efficient work is a product of focus. Train it. Another thing we're not really told, and I think your generation is probably going to struggle with this a lot because you were raised with technology that was very easy to make you distracted. I'm probably older than you, and I still have this problem too. Like, think about your day-to-day behavior. If I walk down the hall to the elevator, as I'm waiting for that elevator to come, where does my hand go? I recognize that I almost instinctively just touch my pocket because I'm so uncomfortable with being just bored there waiting that I need to flick on my phone and do something. If you're on the couch, what are you doing? If you're studying, how often do you have your phone there and you're reading something or TikToking or whatever you do? Every time your mind kind of changes directions there, it comes at a cost. Your ability to think deeply about whatever you're working on gets affected, and you are not going to produce as much work in a given amount of time. So train your focus. And that comes hand in hand with training your time management. And then last little small tip is small behaviors done consistently will yield more than big ones done occasionally. I think a lot of people, when they're trying to get this like self-improvement stuff, they go dramatic, right? You've heard about people doing the crazy diets, but how often are those diets dropped? And it's the same thing with work habits, right? People tell themselves, I'm going to study, I'm going to read 10 chapters today, 10 tomorrow, and I'll be done the course in 2 days. It's not sustainable. You won't do it consistently, and then you won't get the benefits of it. Try to make minor tweaks, but be consistent with your ability to execute them. And that will yield far more in the grand, in the long run than any big gesture. And then practical advice number 4, be a fighter and persevere. You will face challenges, and it's how you handle those that will dictate where you end up in your career. It's not about how smart you are, because you all are bright and have the potential to do what you want to do. It's how you kind of head through these hurdles. And don't do what you want to do for the accolades, for the awards, for the one big change. Do it because you love the process, because that's the only way to stay kind of mentally healthy through the journey. And I do want to finish by saying I realize that I am a white, cisgender, straight male, and am the definition of privilege. So it's not as fair that this is coming from me. And I recognize that many of you will have challenges that I don't. I think these rules are still good guidelines, and I think there are injustices that we need to fix as a group. But even more so, be a fighter and prove the harsh system wrong, that you do have what it takes. So with that, thank you so much. I know I kind of rambled on here, and I would love to take any questions you have.